morning, everyone.
Good morning.
You're very welcome to Galatia Parish Church for our service of the Word on this, the second Sunday of Epiphany. We begin our service by singing together hymn 159, Good Christians All Rejoice. That's 159.
Great are your designs for us.
There is none that can be compared with you.
If I were to proclaim them and tell of them,
they would be more than I am able to express.
Sacrifice and offering you do not desire,
but my ears you have opened.
Burnt offering and sacrifice for sin you have not required.
Then said I, Lo, I come.
In the scroll of the book it is written of me that I should do your will, O my God.
I delight to do it. Your law is within my heart.
I have declared your righteousness in the great congregation.
Behold, I did not restrain my lips, and that, O Lord, you know.
Your righteousness I have not hidden in my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation.
I have not concealed your loving kindness and truth from the great congregation.
Do not withhold your compassion from me, O Lord.
Let your love and your faithfulness always preserve me.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
We stand and sing in 112, There is Our Redeemer. People who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, cast your net into the lake, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fish for people. Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness from among the people. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please. Buzz of Christmas. Tomorrow, Monday the 16th of January, it will be a Blue Monday, when we are all at our lowest after the time down from Christmas. And in the church calendar, Epiphany follows Christmas, so that the hope and light of Christmas follows through into the new year, leading us forward in faith on the journey that lies ahead. And our reading this morning from Matthew chapter 4, verses 12 to 23, speaks of two things. Firstly, fulfillment, and secondly, following Jesus. Fulfillment is a big theme in terms of the Gospel according to Matthew. In the Christmas narratives, as we have read through the Christmas narratives, we have noticed that every so often Matthew will say that this part of the birth narrative was fulfilled, what the prophet said of old. And so fulfillment of the plans and purposes of God is very, very important in Matthew's Gospel. And we get it here in Matthew chapter 4. Jesus has heard that John, his cousin, John the Baptist, has been arrested, and so he withdraws to Galilee. And he leaves Nazareth and he makes his home in Capernaum. And Matthew says that this is the fulfillment of what Isaiah said all those years ago when he said, "Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness hath seen a great light, and those who sat in the region and the shadow of death, the light has dawned." And so every movement, every aspect of Jesus' life, as St. Matthew is seeing the plans and purposes of God being fulfilled. Which raises the question of fulfillment in our own lives. And what does it look like for us in the 21st century? Well, the newspapers and magazines and online articles are all full of hints and tips about how we can find happiness and fulfillment in 2023. And I came across this one in Psychology Today from Dr. Barton Goldsmith. And Dr. Goldsmith suggests 10 things to help us find fulfillment in 2023. Be with others who make you smile, number one. Hold on to your values, and number two. And number three, accept the good. And number four, imagine the best. And number five, do things you love. And number six, find meaning and purpose. And number seven, listen to your heart. Number eight, push yourself, not others. Nine, be open to change. And 10, bask in the simple pleasures. And all of those things we can do in life to find some sense of fulfillment. And fulfillment is vitally important. We need to find a meaning and purpose in our daily lives to help us going day in and day out. And the message of Jesus here in Matthew's Gospel is one of repentance. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come. Now, when we think about that term, repent, we often think of it in a very strictly religious sense of repent from your sins, be sorry for your mistakes. But it's much wider and broader than that in the Greek. It's a change of mind, a change of attitude, a change of direction in life. It's really correcting the negative self-talk with positive self-talk, and reminding yourself of the better path that exists in life. And that was the message of Jesus and repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come. Change your mind, change your attitude, change the direction of travel. Think differently about your relationship with God. Rather than not wanting a relationship with you, he wants a relationship with you. Think differently about your relationships with each other, and they can be healed, they can be mended, there can be reconciliation, there can be a fresh start, and there can be a new chapter. All of these things can be unpacked from the message of Jesus, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come. And for us as Christians, it's really improving our thinking and improving our attitudes as we travel through this new year, when we have those negative thoughts, when we have those times of depression and despair. And we have to find ways of moving in the direction of hope and expectation. We have to think of how we can be more positive in terms of our outlook and what we expect to happen in life. And for the Christian, we have to be in step with the Spirit. Jim Packer, the Anglican theologian, he talks about repentance not just as a one-off thing, but as a daily occurrence of continually repenting, of continually changing your mind and changing your attitude and changing your direction of travel, of realigning yourself so that you are in step with God's Spirit. And we know when we are in step with God's Spirit and we are going down the right path, and we know that when we're out of step and we're going down the wrong path. And for some of us, that will be a daily battle of repenting and changing our thinking and changing our attitude and outlook in life. And so the message of Jesus brings us to that place of finding meaning and purpose in life, so that we find fulfillment in our existence. Fulfillment, the first part of the passage. The second part is following Jesus. And we hear of two sets of brothers. We hear of Simon, called Peter, and Andrew, casting their nets in the lake, for they were fishermen. And Jesus, he says to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And so these fishermen become fishers of men. And we all know what that means. It means winning the hearts and minds of those who existed at that time, winning them to the message and the cause of Jesus Christ. And so they left their nets behind and they embarked on a new trade, a trade of winning people for Jesus. And this reminds us what's ultimately important in life. People are important in life. In the materialistic world in which we live in, we can objectify people and we can lose sight of what is of true value and worth. And yet you and I and those around us are of true value and worth. You can't get anything more valuable than a human being. And we have to remind ourselves of that. These fishermen, they left their nets to go and win people for Jesus. They saw value and worth in the lives of those who they encountered in that day and in that age. And for our young people, they need to hear this as they're growing up, that they are of value and of worth, because with social media and the peer pressures and the mixed messages that are out there in this very materialistic, instant culture that we live in, they need to be reminded that ultimately what is important is of the heart and of the mind, it is of the body and the spirit, that they are of value and worth. And then we hear of another set of brothers. We hear of James and John, and we hear that they are quite content about their business. They are mending their nets, they're getting ready to go out to catch more fish. And they encounter Jesus, and they leave their boat and their father Zebedee, and they follow him in life. And we're told that Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, reminding us that Jesus was Jewish, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every manner of disease. And Matthew here is describing Jesus as the teacher, the preacher, and the healer. And that is who James and John, Peter and Andrew followed in life. And for them it was very different because they could actually see Jesus. They could experience him in that sort of physical sense of watching how he conducted himself, how he engaged with villagers, how he engaged with religious leaders, how he engaged with the authorities. That they could physically see and observe the manner of Jesus Christ. For us in the 21st century, it's very different. We can't physically see Jesus. The only access we have to him is in terms of the accounts written in the Gospels. But by his Spirit, we believe that he dwells with us and that he walks alongside us in life. And so the question arises, how do we follow Jesus in the 21st century? What would that look like? Well, it's in how we conduct our lives, how we live our everyday lives, how we treat others, what we say to them, and what we do for them. And Matthew is really setting us up for the next few chapters in the Gospel, chapters 5, 6, and 7, where we hear about the Sermon on the Mount. And within the Sermon on the Mount, we have the teaching and instruction of Jesus. And apart from next week, we will then have a short series on the Sermon on the Mount, where we'll be able to unpack what that teaching is and how that might apply to our lives in the 21st century. And the Sermon on the Mount is the place to go to if you are ever wondering what the teaching of Jesus is. And we'll have opportunity to do that in the coming weeks and months. And so, discipleship is so important in the 21st century, but we must acknowledge that we live in a very different world, in a very different time and place. And so there's a challenge not just to understand the teaching, but to put it into practice in the here and now. And so following Jesus is as important now as ever it was, just as important today in Peter and Andrew and James and John's time. It looks different and it's a different experience, but it's so, so important. So as we journey through this long month of January, my prayer is that we, on a daily basis, we find meaning and purpose, that we would find fulfillment in the basic things of life, that we would be reminded of the good things, the things that are for us, the things that God has richly blessed us with, that we would find fulfillment in those things. And as we live our lives not just for ourselves, but we follow Jesus and we look out for the needs of those around us. And may God give us wisdom and understanding as we seek to be his followers in 2023. Let us pray. Our gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your plans and purposes in the life of Jesus and indeed in our own lives. We pray, Father, that you would help us to find meaning and purpose. Help us to reflect on your goodness. Remind us of the good things in our lives, of the people who are around us, the food and drink that we enjoy. And we pray, Father, that as we live our lives, that you would help us to follow in the footsteps of your Son, Jesus Christ, and help us to use our gifts and abilities so that we might be a light shining in darkness, that we might speak the words of encouragement and grace to those who are around us. We pray, Father, that as we seek to be followers of him, that you would equip us for that task. For this we ask in your name. Amen. mercy upon us. Our Father, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray in confidence, knowing that we bring our prayers to a merciful and everlasting God. We pray today for your blessing to be upon this congregation, upon each member of it, upon our church, and all Christian churches throughout the world, especially those caught up in the conflict in Ukraine. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Eternal God, light of the nations, in Christ you make all things new. Guide our nation in the coming days with inspiration of your Spirit, that understanding may put an end to discord and bitterness. We pray for our political leaders and community activists, and for all those who are working to shape our society. May they be guided by the example of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving Lord, we pray for our young people, for the young people in our families and in our communities. May they grow up knowing love and hope, valuing life and respecting others. Give them courage and resilience as they face changes in their lives, and help them to see opportunities in all the challenges that stretch out before them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we pray for your healing touch to rest upon those who are sick, your strength to be felt by those who are tired, your wisdom and your love to encourage those who live with despair and fear. We think of the people we know who are suffering in mind, body, or spirit, and we offer you our personal prayers for them, as we name them in the quietness of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving Lord, may your presence be seen clearly in everything we do and say each day throughout the coming week. We pray that your joy and your love will flow freely in us and through us as we follow where you lead us. In a time of silence, we bring our own personal prayers before the throne of grace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore. Amen. Amen. Our thanks to James and Annette for acting as wardens today, and to Lynn and the choir for their part in the service. And next week we have our family service, and it's a special Christingle service. So please do spread the word, and next week encourage boys and girls to come along for our special Christingle service. We close with a lesson. Let us pray. May Christ, who is the light of the world, shine in your lives and gladden your hearts by the peace of his presence. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all whom you love, this day and forevermore. Amen.